Well, good afternoon. Welcome to this next set of lectures in our series on data science in the public realm. We've got five and probably ultimately six of these sessions. We had one a couple of weeks ago with Dame Julia Slingo, who's the chief scientific scientist at the Met Office. And what we're trying to do is to get prominent figures in who have duties in public life that require data science to make them work, and to pair them with academics who will give the second lecture in each of these paired sessions, which bring to bear some research ideas which hopefully are relevant to the first lecture. So sort of an interesting scheme, which I hope you'll enjoy. So we've got a couple more coming before Christmas. You'll see them in the on the programme. Do please come. Today, I'm very, very pleased to welcome Professor Anthony Finkelstein, who's very well known to the Alan Turing Institute. In fact, he's on our board of trustees. What he's been doing for much of his career is developing methodology in software engineering. He's been a professor at UCL. He's also been the Dean of Engineering Science there. And a lot of his academic work has been on developing formal approaches to developing complex software systems and resolving the complex issues that come up when you try to do that. He's also on the council of the EPSRC, the Engineering and Physical Sciences Research Council. And most recently, since being Dean of Engineering Science at UCL, he's switched to a completely new role as Chief Scientific Advisor for National Security. And of course, this sounds absolutely fascinating. So I invited Anthony to come here and tell us something about how he sees the role of data science in his new set of challenges. Anthony, we're very much looking forward to your lecture.
So if you'll bear with me for a moment, but it's rather foolishly, I'm going to try and do this, use my laptop for my iPad as my speaking aid, and I'm going to hope that that works. Well, thank you very much, Andrew, for that introduction. The first thing to say is that I'm very pleased to see so many friends represented in the audience, and standing from this vantage point, I can see more and more as I look around. The second thing to say is how pleased and proud I am to be here now. The Alan Turing Institute is sort of up and running. It's been, an administrative, legal construct for some time. It's been a headache for longer, but actually seeing it come to life in the way it is now is an extraordinary pleasure. And it's an act not simply of a very dedicated managerial team and director, but also the act of a committed community, and represented, much also represented here. And so I'm very pleased to see that as well. So something of my background a computer scientist has already been outlined. I'm a second-rate software engineering researcher and certainly a third-rate data scientist. You should bear that strongly in mind with the comments that follow. And I am very much going to address the principal theme, which is the setting, the context, the policy and public context into which data science fits. And the first thing you probably need to know is what's a chief scientific advisor? Now, that's actually a unique role in the UK. There's no real direct equivalent in other countries, though some of the Commonwealth countries, New Zealand being an example, are beginning to follow the model. And the role of chief scientific advisors is normally taken on for a period of 3 to 5 years by people who have, like myself, had a career as a as what passes for a practicing scientist in university or similar research establishments. The role's been in place roughly since just after the war, and the role really has three dimensions. The first is that it's concerned with managing research programs within particular areas of government. The second is it's concerned with providing critical challenge in areas of government from a scientific perspective. So the role of a chief scientific advisor is to sit in the senior executive councils within government and every so often to spring from your chair and shout data, evidence, experiment, and mostly be shouted down, though not always. The third aspect is to work as a network of scientists across government. So many of the challenges that we face now, societal challenges, are ones which cross the various silos into which government is traditionally partitioned. And chief scientific advisors actually operate as a network across that. So important issues, like, for example, the ethics of data science, or problems in the area of energy and smart metering, might in fact require a collaboration across many different areas of government, and indeed scientific advice coming from a range of different perspectives. So the role of chief scientific advisor for national security is a relatively recently established one, though it has a long history. It was originally proposed by Patrick Blackett just immediately after the war, and of course many people here will be familiar with the work of R.V. Jones, whose excellent book Most Secret War I highly commend to everyone. I think it was called The Wizard War in the American edition, but if you can get hold of it, certainly do. It's an excellent read. So that bit of the preliminaries out of the way. The second thing I will say is that I'm proud to be a computer scientist in government. And computer science has a particular contribution to bring, I think. The first is the sort of obvious one, which is government needs computer scientists because of the central role that computing and information technology play within our economy. And that role is both as a primary economic producer, but also its role in terms of supporting our infrastructure and all of the various activities, both for economic and societal good. The second thing is that computer scientists bring to government a range of tools and methods, and data science is the latest one of these. Probably one of the most impactful, I think, in terms of how computing is perceived in government. But it's not the only area in which computer science is able to contribute new methods. The third, and I think important dimension of this, is that computer science brings a characteristic way of thinking. We've got a name for that now, you know, computational thinking. And actually, what computational thinking brings in government is this very powerful analogy between the process of building policies and building software. That in some senses, there's a deep structural similarity between those processes, which is very rich in terms of how it allows us as computer scientists to think about the policy process. So with that out the way, I want to say, you know, the theme I'm going to be discussing is science, and particularly data science and computer science, in the context of national, in the context of national security. And it would seem wrong if I didn't precede this by making some reference to the collective threat. The collective threat we face. And I think that people are all aware, and certainly it's been widely presented in the news, both of the threat we face from terrorism, largely international terrorism, and from the threat we increasingly face from aggressive, hostile states. These are critical threats, and I believe, and I think in the case of terrorism, it seems reasonably evident that the success in combating Daesh overseas has led to increased awareness of the threat that international terrorism poses to the UK in terms of the threat that terrorism poses. I believe that we have a collective responsibility to both think about those threats and to take steps to counter them. And I'm going to say a little bit more about that as I proceed. So my talk has three parts. The first of these is I'm going to orient you a bit to national security and the science of national security. The second is I'm going to say something about the environment, the technological environment in which work on national security is currently placed. And the third is I'm going to talk a bit about how national security is organized. And the final bit is I'm going to point to some particular technological challenges which are interesting, and many of which actually are on the research agenda for the Alan Turing Institute. For those of you who want more details of some of that, I highly commend the talk that was given at the Institute by Bill Oxbury, whose slides I think are extremely informative. And so people who are interested in more detail on some of these points could make useful reference to those slides. So, national security. National security is basically about protecting the citizens of this country and its allies from harm. It's about protecting our democracy, our system of laws, and our collective prosperity. It is an activity that is undertaken in the UK under strict observation of the law of laws, with a well-developed system of oversight, and governed by the key principles of necessity and proportionality. I plan to come back to the issue, particularly proportionality, a little later in my talk. In the UK, the national security apparatus has three key missions. These missions are defined by the Strategic Defence and Security Review, the so-called SDSR, which sets out our security and defence strategy for the next four or five years. It's It's not the most enthralling of reads, but certainly worth a skim if you get a chance. The three elements of this, the protection of citizens of the UK and its allies from terrorism. The second of these is the is the protection of citizens of the country and its allies from cyber threats, and to make the UK cyber domain a safe one for people to be. And the third, and to transact business, clearly. And the third of these is to gain foresight for the UK on the intentions and actions of other countries, and particularly those that might wish the UK harm. So that's the basic mission. And clearly, to satisfy that mission covers a very large technological breadth. And the constraints of this talk mean that I won't be able to cover the entire range. I'm going to stick to my last principally focusing on computing and data. Now, in this domain, it's clear also that confidentiality and secrecy play an important role. The first thing to say in this regard is that such confidentiality and secrecy is designed to protect the methods that are used in this domain from the countermeasures that might be used by a hostile adversary. Things are kept confidential and secret in order, obviously, to protect individuals, but also to provide methods that can be used to offset future risk that might emerge, that might at some time emerge. Now, it's worthwhile saying that, and the case of cryptography has been the one that maybe has detained our community, on the whole, nothing keeps us more secure than a prosperous economy, and nothing keeps us more secure than the ability for people to go about their daily business protected from crime and from personal threat. And in making a calculation about what is necessary in terms of confidentiality and secrecy, it is well understood that these concerns have primacy in the public sphere. So, now to turn for a moment to the environment in which national security operates. Conventionally, we have found ourselves, or most recently, in a setting of what has been described as asymmetric conflict. In an asymmetric conflict, your adversary has certain advantages. The adversary, your asymmetric adversary, has certain advantages. They have tactical flexibility, and they are able to contemplate actions that you might not wish to contemplate or certainly to undertake. This provides them with an advantage. Conversely, that is opposed by an asymmetric advantage on the part of a nation state. That asymmetric advantage is the resources and technological capability that a nation state can muster to overcome the asymmetric threat posed by an adversary. So they have the flexibility we have the science and tech and resources. And then it's a matter of how the balance works out. Usually resources wins out over the tactical flexibility, not always. But that's the hope. And you contrast this, you see, with a traditional symmetric conflict, the Cold War being an example, where you've got two adversaries, and it's the person who can muster the biggest resources that essentially wins, because you're matching like with like. The problem is that the asymmetric advantage of nation states is declining. And the reason the asymmetric advantage of nation states is declining is, before this, nation states were able to, nation states were able to, had the dominance in research, had the dominance in science and technology, and were able to deploy, that. But increasingly, adversaries, for example, hostile non-state actors, are able to leverage technologies that stem from the global R&D capability of software and engineering industries. So, you want end-to-end encrypted communication, download it from the App Store. You want a drone, buy it from eBay. You want a localized precision manufacturing capability, print it yourself, and so on and so forth. You can draw from the products of a research and development enterprise much larger than any government can actually muster. And then you can go on. You can because of course you're able to draw on information resources that are also global. And of course we combine this with the fact that science and technology is globalized. It's no longer the case that the UK and its allies can say it has unparalleled access to science and technology expertise. The base for science and technology is now much more widely dispersed, and the capability for local production, these are being is greater with globalized supply chains, and so on and so forth. Lastly, the speed and diversity of the development of different technologies is just astonishing, and even if nation states are capable of responding, the capabilities that they are able to develop tend to be fragile. So, from being able, in some senses, from being a on the front foot technologically, security and defence, actually more broadly, is now, if not on the back foot, at least doing a little dance in the middle. So, clearly, there's going to be a need then for, in some senses, repositioning how we do science and technology in the national security interest, and being able to work much more closely and in much closer partnership with industry and commerce, and be able to use the outcomes of research in a much more agile, fashion than hitherto. Okay, so the next thing I want to say is say something a little bit about the organization of national security. So conventionally, national security has been divided into a set of different functions, differentiated largely by the ways in which they collect information. Thus, there are different categories of intelligence: human intelligence, classically called HUMINT; signal intelligence, classically called SIGINT; measurement and instrumentation intelligence, and so on, and so forth. But to a large extent, these rather conventional ways of thinking about the world of security intelligence are broken down. What happens in a setting where much of the human intelligence is actually embodied in and accessible only through digital digital platforms? What happens when our large-scale communication platforms and the ways in which we sense our environment start to merge in new and interesting ways, as they clearly already are? Then the ways in which national security has traditionally been organized have in some senses to be rethought. And this also reflects on what you might call the other dimension of the way in which we currently organize national security, which is in terms of what's called the intelligence cycle. So the idea is you observe some phenomenon, you collect information, basically by tasking a set of collection assets. You perform some primary analysis. You conduct an assessment. You make a decision based on that assessment, and then you act in order to diminish the threat or deter. And then you go about round the circle again, deciding what you need to observe and selecting your collection assets and so on and so forth. Okay. Now, many of you will recognize this cycle as looking now comes the software engineer. It's looking a bit like the old waterfall model that software engineers are very familiar with. It's sort of linear process, and you don't really know whether you got what you wanted until the very end. Okay, so clearly that already starts to ring alarm bells. But the important thing here is that I want to get the intelligence cycle of to basically sit inside that of an adversary. So I want to be able to observe and act faster than an adversary might be able to observe and act. And it's quite clear that this loop, suitable to the rather lumbering Cold War settings for which it was originally developed, doesn't actually deliver for the sorts of rapidly moving threats and changing and morphing environment in which we currently find ourselves. So both of those things suggest that it's not just about technology, but about new ways of working and new organizational architectures. Okay, so this is now, that's sort of concludes the bit about the policy environment. I now want to say something rather specific about computing and software technologies. Clearly, both in some senses, a key vector for the threat and also a key opportunity for actually countering that threat. And I thought I would cover two areas that are of particular relevance to the ATI. The first is I want to make some comments about computer security and the second is I'm going to say something about data science. So from the computer security standpoint, I'm actually an optimist. So I believe quite passionately, that many of the problems that we are currently experiencing with the plethora of vulnerabilities and ways of exploiting those vulnerabilities, that is a problem that we have now an increasingly better handle on. So I believe that I believe that verification technologies, particularly also verification technologies used at runtime. I believe the power of machine learning applied in security settings, as for example exemplified by the recent DARPA Grand Challenge on vulnerability finding. I believe that advances in cryptography, advances in the state of software engineering practice. I believe that all of these things are already giving us a significant advantage. So, you know, and I think, you know, for software practitioners, I think just good libraries are already making an enormous difference. So the cost of finding vulnerabilities is going up rapidly. Now, we've got a window, because we've got a lot of legacy, and we've got sort of the new legacy predominant in things like the Internet of Things, devices, and so on. But actually, take a positive view. I think that we're increasingly getting on top of that. But that doesn't mean that that the problem of security goes away. Indeed, I think that we have to look somewhere else for where the new set of really interesting security challenges are emerging. The first is to say that computation is ultimately physical. So, at the bottom level, all software engineering reduces to physics, and we need to take into account. Oh, good, John is disagreeing, which is good. To a certain extent, we are in a position whereby the exploitation of the physics and the exploitations of the side channels that the physical nature of computation provides us, I think, is something which increasingly we are going to have to pay attention to. I think the whole question of the electromagnetic environment is another thing which we probably need to pay some attention to. The grey-haired members of the audience, or those who, like me, have none, or very little at any rate, I think that this is a bit back to the future, but I think it also presents a very rising risk. Supply chains are critical as well. There's no use in, for example, having verified your card payment software when you don't know where the ribbon cable came from. And actually, the whole question of how the supply chain and what trust you can place in the different components of the side chain, of the supply chain, strongly come into play. And lastly, the whole question of physical security. I think the meeting point between physical and, I don't like the word cybersecurity, but we'll use it, and cybersecurity come into play. You know, as we know, there's no use in having all sorts of trusted components if ultimately you have somebody has access, physical access to your system. And there's a need, I think, to develop a new type of combined science that brings together, again, the physical and the computing security. So, conscious of time, I'll just run through the other dimensions of this. Okay, so data science, I believe, poses a big opportunity. Data science, of course, isn't just about opportunity from a security perspective, because data science also runs the risk of potentially exposing methods that in national security we might otherwise not wish to disclose. The key elements here, I think, in the data science area, the most important element is that of privacy and trust. I think we already have a very strong idea about the analytic power that such techniques provide. But I think we need to think much more deeply about the privacy and trust implications of the technologies that we are using. Now, this comes down to the question I signaled earlier about proportionality. Now, at the moment, the notion of proportionality is a judgmental matter that practitioners and those responsible for oversight deal with. But actually, what happens if we were able to do much more about protecting privacy to just the point and be able to do data mining and analytics while maintaining privacy? And I think that's something which the state of the art is already beginning to suggest we might be able to have some handle on. So I think that's a very interesting and important dimension. The next question is the issue of provenance. It's very important within the national security setting to be able to track the provenance of data and to be able to provide assurances. And I mean that in that, you know, I actually mean that not just in the sort of personal sense, but actually in the formal sense of that, to provide assurances that that inferences are made only on data whose provenance carries the right level of guarantees about the privacy which is afforded for individuals. And again, I think this is an interesting challenge for the Alan Turing Institute. No ATI talk, I think, probably should go should not mention the two other areas. One is skills and the critical importance of data science skills. At the moment, I think we already have a situation in which we have many more tools in our kit bag than we have people who are competent to use those tools. And that is a critical challenge which we are all going to have to collectively face. And then there is the question, the related question of usability, and actually making the next set of data science capabilities usable, both in terms of their front end and actually in terms of the way in which the techniques might be applied at the back end. That includes within it, I think, the neglected area of visualization, which I think is still very much more an art than a science. So with that, I think I'll conclude. My final sentence is really that I think that data science is potentially a strategic scientific platform for national security. We are pleased to be working in partnership with the Alan Turing Institute as part of the Defence and Security Defence and Security Partnership. And I think I'll stop there.
Well, do take a seat. Now we move slightly unconventionally into our kind of breakfast TV section. So before you get to ask questions, Anthony and I are going to relax in the studio here without the benefit of any breakfast, unfortunately. But I could pour you a glass of water there. I think you have deserved that after all the
thank you.
All the hard work at the front there. So anyway, how it goes is that, excuse me, I get to ask one or two questions in this kind of relaxed setting, and then it'll be over to you for...
I feel so relaxed.
Are you relaxed? So I suppose, I haven't analysed who is out here in the audience. I think there are probably people from all kinds of backgrounds, some from companies and some doing research and so on. But from the point of view of the Turing, I think we're very interested to know if there are things we can do to help with these great challenges. So the challenge that you've enunciated of keeping the country safe, I mean, I find very compelling, and I'm sure many people will find compelling. But I think in general terms, a question that we all have, and also I want to dig into this in a bit more detail as we go along, is what can people who are doing research do towards kind of furthering the aims of national security? And perhaps to make it a little bit more specific, as a starter, how do you think we can work with government departments? I mean, what are the kind of, including especially national security, what are the interfaces? How does a researcher go about kind of making contact with the parts that are going to really enable the opportunities?
Okay. So the first answer to that is a sort of statement of personal research credo. I'm a believer in the in what has become termed challenge-based research. I've become increasingly a believer in that over my research career. I sometimes find that the business of immersing oneself in a specific practical challenge often gives rise to much more general scientific challenges, and also keeps you grounded at the same time. And across government, we have many societally worthwhile and important challenges, and they range from food safety and production. At one end, right across to the complex modelling and computational challenges of maintaining the UK's national deterrent, through to national security. So there's a very broad range of those, and I suppose the answer is that, everybody will have a particular predilection, or there will be particular challenges that they think suit their their research, and they should pick and choose. They should choose.
What's the way in? I mean, chief scientific advisor, you seem like a very friendly chief scientific advisor. Is that generally a good place to start?
Yeah, I think that's a good place. I think that's a good place to start. I think there are already a series of partnerships that are evolving in the security and defence partnership. I think we've evolved what I think is a rather good problem book, actually rather challenging problem book. And so I think that might be a good start,
How do we get to read the problem book?
I think that's in that's open to ATI members to the best of my to the best of my knowledge.
Okay, well, that's
so
a very good.
I think that I think that talking to CSAs and their research teams is a good and productive way of going about things. So I think that's a good way to gain access as well.
I mean, for yourself as a CSA, do you think of yourself as, to what extent do you think of yourself as doing science? And immersed? I mean, you've already talked about the scientific method, about computational thinking, for example, you mentioned, and how that is a sort of useful construct. That's sort of at a fairly general level. I mean, getting down to some of the more specific technical levels, you talked about Internet of Things. Of course, recent news stories have got us all worrying a little bit more about the security of Internet of Things. I mean, how deeply, as a CSA, would you expect to get into that sort of technology? Or would you be looking for other people?
That's a good example. I mean, it's a good example because it's certainly been on, firstly, Internet of Things has been on the government foresight agenda for a significant period.
Yeah.
The Government Office for Science, under the aegis of the government chief scientific advisor, Sir Mark Walport, has also produced a very good Blackett report on the Internet of Things, which includes a series of which sets out a series of challenges for society and for government, and clearly it's been on the research agenda of actually pretty much most of the CSAs, one way and another, ranging from transport to energy, smart cities, and so on. And it's been on the security agenda for some significant period as well.
By the way, a useful bit of trivia there. Is that Blackett the same as the Blackett you mentioned earlier on that invented CSAs?
That is the same Blackett.
Excellent, excellent. That's good to know.
No, he invented the idea of a national security CSA. Probably difficult to know exactly who you'd credit with CSAs as a whole.
Right.
Probably Solly Zuckerman.
Fine. A slightly more edgy question, I suppose, I wanted to ask you. There have been a couple of court cases recently. There was one back in February 2015, one just last month here, about the security services' use of information and whether it is indeed proportionate to the problem at hand. And I'm curious to know what your view is of the court findings and the situation.
Okay, so legal oversight is a part of national security. That's and it's proper in a democracy that such legal oversight is in place. And where those who are concerned with these things make judgments, those judgments should be subject to proper scrutiny and remedy where appropriate. I think the most recent I'm not best placed to comment on the most recent decision, but I think there's one important ramification which it draws to attention, which is that the importance of a legal framework, which is very clear on the permissions and the steps that one is permitted to take in a national security, in a national security setting. And the Investigatory Powers Bill provides us with enhanced ability to do that.
To go back to researchers again, and researchers thinking about how they can get involved in these rather pressing challenges, I mean, I suppose a lot of the work for us is to kind of drill through to some specific things that we can really help with, and sort of get through the layers of generality to, okay, what's the thing we can really help with? So if you were to choose just one challenge which has a sort of strong technical component, because after all, that's, I mean, the Turing Institute has a whole range of people, actually, and, you know, we have mathematicians, statisticians, computer scientists, we also have social scientists, we have engineers.
Yeah.
That's the sort of range of talents and interests. I mean, if you were to pick just one thing where you think people with kind of with some of those skills could really make a difference, what would it be?
I think privacy is the one that I think, and what capabilities we have to be able to do interesting kinds of computation while maintaining the data.
Right.
While maintaining the data, while maintaining anonymity, however defined.
I guess this is very interesting for us, because that's, you know, we hear this not just from people with your sorts of interests, but for example, when we've talked to people doing biomedical research, they haven't asked us to come and help sequence their genes, because I think they're probably already pretty good at that. But the thing that does seem to come up in quite a few contexts is this, the ability to use data in a way that, as you say, preserves privacy.
I mean, this is really interesting because, of course, it's of interest in the national security setting, but it's actually also really interesting in the commercial setting. So the ability to be able to hand over data to a service-providing organisation, to allow that service-providing organisation to do analytics relevant to the service that it is providing, but to be able to have, ideally, as I said, formal guarantees that other features of that data set are not easy to infer.
Right.
That would be really
valuable. That works well in security settings, in health settings. I think it's actually of interest rather broadly for the Institute, because as a new Institute, we want to be able to do research which is reproducible.
Yeah.
On the other hand, we also understand the privilege of having partners who can provide us with very special data that nonetheless they may not want to release publicly. So, you know, these kinds of technologies may help us.
And I guess, relevant to your earlier question about legal oversight, the issue of provenance is the other one which I draw attention to. The ability to be able to say, actually, this inference has been made only using information which has been permissioned for this specific class of inference to be made, is also really important. So being able to track that, and to make quite sure that at all times you are confident about the quality of the inferences you're making and the context, and the context and assurance of compliance.
Yeah. One last thing, and soon be time for the general audience to chip in. One last thing I wanted to ask you about is, you did mention visualization, and you know that's something I have a sort of, I guess, a bit of a bad conscience about, because it's terribly important. I mean, if you want to communicate your findings in data science, of course, you know, we must be good at visualization. And I have a sort of sense that there must be a good research topic there. I mean, if there's good visualization and bad visualization, then there must be research into, you know, what's the difference between the two. But for myself, I'm not sure how one should go about that. I don't know if you have views on
that. Well, the first thing to say is that I've actually been interested in visualization for a very long time. And when I was head of computer science at UCL, I was very interested in finding people particularly who are doing interesting work on scientific visualization.
Mm-hmm.
And they're like hen's teeth. Mm-hmm. There are not many people on this topic, not very much research. And much of the work that I've seen on visualization is, how can I say this without being impolite?
Is
a bit unprincipled.
Mm.
It's sort of look at my nice.
Rather than science, you said.
Yeah, it's look at my nice picture. And indeed, you know, there may be a lot of work in it, and it may indeed be a nice picture. But it's clear that, and if we want to meaningfully communicate outcomes in the context of big data, then visualization has to be has things, and there has to be, as you say, principles about how this should be how this should be done. And you might really want also somehow to be able to embed that computationally. In other words, you want to be able to say, show me a picture that will interest me.
Mm.
And that's, you know, that we don't, yeah. Or, you know, I don't know when people, and I've been in my past lives, receipt of much management data.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you get snowed by loads and loads. Anybody, I'm on the board of an NHS hospital, and I get, you know, 70 pages of little bar charts on performance. And you flick through and you go, what the hell am I supposed to make of this? You know, what I'd love to be able to do is go to the data and go, surprise me, show me what I should be worried about. And we aren't there yet.
Mm.
So I think there's something really interesting to be done
good
in that regard. But what it is, I don't know.
Well, our audience have been very patient with us during our breakfast time here. So it seems only fair now to open the floor to them.
If you think so, yeah, you haven't been facing that way.
Oh, right. They were fidgeting with us. So questions from the audience, cordially invited, please. If you have a question, please stick up your hand, and also a microphone will come winging its way towards you so that people on the end of our link, here we have a question right in the middle, equidistant between two microphones, which one is going to win? Here we are. Please tell us who you are and ask your question.
Thank you. My name is Anders Goransson, and we heard earlier here in part of the discussion regarding the Internet of Things. Part of the Internet of Things, we see how blockchain technology is starting to make itself more and more established. So my question to Professor Finkelstein is, from a national security point of view, how will we actually see blockchain? Is it a savior or is it another threat?
Well, I mean, neither is the obvious, you know, is the obvious answer. I'm going to fit in the middle. So, you know, in some senses, you know, if we need to provide distributed information in a tamper-proof way, what we now have is a set of architectures which allow us to do that. And it means that, whereas hitherto that was, in some senses, a very tough design and architecture problem, we now have a pattern, of which blockchain is a particular implementation, for actually being able to achieve that. And indeed, distributed tamper-proof registers are something that crops up in all over the place. So it's probably something you're going to need to do to deal with provenance. It's probably something that we're going to need to do in order to manage distributed trust in other other settings. It's probably part of the answer to do with how we make assurances over supply chains. And it may well have application in Internet of Things technology. So it's not a It's not an answer to everything, but it provides a powerful architectural pattern we can use more generally.
Question down here.
Thank you. Dave Marcel, I'm a BCS member amongst other things. September saw the announcement of a compromise beginning 2014 when Yahoo lost its digital certificates in California. And as a result, one of our main providers in this country sacrificed or gave away or wasn't aware of the leaking of 8 million sets of dates of birth, home addresses, names, and everything else in their emails. The end of September also saw the end of the UK cert, and I'm sure these will be problems for the new Joint Security Centre once the CEO's in place. But the problem seems to be, from my viewpoint, is the weaponization of the internet. John will, I'm sure, tell us in a minute that these things are not new since 96 with various IETF RFCs on how to secure the IoT today, which we still haven't listened to. Is there an internal conflict in taking the cert into the dark side? Thank you.
Okay, so there's a set of questions. So the first thing to say is that this government, as its predecessor, I think has been very forward leaning on the whole issue of cybersecurity. It has invested very significantly, not least, you know, both in terms of supporting academic research and in the actions necessary to reach out to industry. And yesterday's announcements, coinciding with the new national cybersecurity strategy, I think are very important ones. I believe that the establishment of the National Cybersecurity Centre signals that commitment and provides a significant body of resources into it. Your question, of course, had a sting at the end, and the obvious response to that is it is vital that the people responsible for providing advice on cybersecurity and contributing to the methods for developing it have a profound and informed understanding of the threat we face. It's quite clear that one would not wish a capability which did not have that.
There's another question down here.
Thanks. Charlie Muirhead from Cognition X. I had a question. Obviously, the Brexit vote was a pretty major decision, and I was wondering what the challenges and opportunities around both Britain coming out of the EU and also all the different privacy challenges across Europe when it comes to national security, both from a challenge and the research opportunities there.
Mm-hmm. Okay, well, the first thing to say is that speaking as I am, sort of in some sense, half in my government capacity and half as an academic, I wouldn't want to tread too far, you know, onto the political questions surrounding Brexit. The obviously much of the domain of national security is a matter between nation states rather than governed by the European Union. I mean, there's some things at the margins, but this is largely a matter of states, and to date, these arrangements have been unaffected by the prospective political changes. Clearly, there are political questions stemming from the Brexit on, firstly, you know, questions about privacy and data protection, which we will have to collectively resolve. Just as there are probably questions about regulation and technology regulation, which also will bear on that, on cybersecurity specifically. The National Cybersecurity Strategy signals Britain's collective intention to ensure that security more generally and cybersecurity specifically are things which Britain is known as being good at and committed to, and that Britain will be a place, a safe place, a globally safe place to do business.
Time for one last quick question. We have one here halfway down. Keep going. Excellent.
Thank you. I'll try to make it quick. I'm Vera Hazelwood from the Smith Institute. So you mentioned that the decision-making model that follows the waterfall model is outdated and it needs to be changed and to be more agile. I wonder whether you can expand on that and explain how it should change, and in particular how data science can help us in that, specifically in the situations where decisions are very of a very agile nature, so they need to be made without the full picture, without the full evidence and information, so is decision-making under uncertainty? Thank you.
Well, to a certain extent, what I represented in my talk was, as it were, the aspiration to, or the sort of recognition that that was something that was going to be necessary. But I deeply regret that I'm not going to be able to actually give a real answer to that, except probably to say that the kernel of an answer is embedded in the way you formulated your question, which is, I think, that actually the notion of data science as a way of stitching together an analysis around data as a way of stitching together agile actors, each, as you say, acting in the context of uncertainty. I think that somehow embedded in that is indeed an answer. So it's possibly an answer to that question.
Great. Well, at this point, we get to have a break. There's tea, I believe, out in the foyer. We get a quarter of an hour to enjoy tea. Please come back around 20 past. And Professor John Crowcroft, who's a faculty fellow in the Institute, will be giving us the companion lecture. And in the meantime, thanks very much to Anthony for a fascinating lecture.